Today I'm gonna talk to you about Async.io. Before we start, I have a quick poll. Actually, a couple of polls. Have you, has any one of you heard of Node.js? Okay, about everyone, almost. Have you heard of Go?
Yeah.
Okay. Have you heard of one of these frameworks? Twisted, Tornado, GEvent, Greenlet? Okay. And does anyone work with Thread and Python? It's a tricky question, but okay. So, most of you probably know a bit about this talk. Especially people who worked in the past with Async.io and Python 3.5, maybe some. Okay. So I want to first to start with why I think event loop is a revolution. So all of the languages we talked about previously are more or less about event loop. So how does it work? So the thing is, we can see a coroutine as a function and the event loop as a circular buffer that contains all the coroutines that are currently running. A coroutine has got a status which can be either waiting, I'm waiting for something, ready, I'm ready to continue running, or done. So the CPU will go around the coroutine if it matches or it's reading a coroutine that is waiting. It will pass to the next one. If the next coroutine is done, it will remove it from the circular buffer and set the parent coroutine, so the coroutine that called this done coroutine, as ready. And as soon as it matches a ready coroutine, it will continue or resume its execution. So, yeah, you can think about that. The CPU is going all around and find something ready, do it. If in the coroutine there is a call to another coroutine, it will add it to the circular buffer. So, how do we define the coroutine? So in Python 3, and especially Python 3.7, we define the coroutine as if it were the function. But instead of just writing def my coroutine, we add this async keyword. And this async keyword will enable us to use another keyword that is called await. And then, the first coroutine of our program, we will ask Async.io to run it, and that's it. It works as a function, so you can also write any Python code you like. But what is important to keep in mind is that at some point you need to use some await to release, to tell the CPU to look at other coroutines as well. So if your code doesn't use any await, you might ask yourself the question, why am I using Async.io? One lib that is really interesting in this Async.io ecosystem is the IO HTTP library that does both client side of the HTTP request and the server side. In this case, we are showing the client-side one. So we create a session. You can see the async with keyword that is actually calling client session with a await. And at the end of the with clause, it will automatically do a await session.close for you. So if you don't want to use async with, don't forget to await the close of the session or the request. So it looks like a request, Python request code, more or less. They try to keep the same API. And here I'm sending a record to Quinto using a post with some JSON. And I'm using race for status to make sure everything went well. And then I'm waiting for the JSON response. So you can note also the await here. Everything that is going through the network, like sending a request, waiting for the response, reading the response context, it's something that can be slow with regard to the bandwidth, the internet bandwidth. So in this case, we want to release the CPU of our program and set the coroutine in a wait until it's ready again. Another thing that is really interesting with Async I/O is the gather function that allows you to run multiple coroutines in parallel. So in this case, I want to create two to-dos at the same time. So I can create my to-dos, which will return a coroutine object, like instance. And then I can ask Async I/O to run all of them in parallel. And I will receive an array with the result of each coroutine in the same order of the array of the gather action. So here you might not know this star thing in front of the variable. It's to expand the action array as parameters of the gather function. So to me, Async I/O really shines when we have a program that is both CPU bound and I/O bound at the same time. I have two use cases that I want to tell you about today to explain how it can work. So to start with, CPU bound function is something that it's a program that takes all the CPU that is available. In Python, usually it's only one core, but if we have a better or quicker or faster or more powerful CPU, the program will run faster. An I/O bound program, it's the other way around. Like most of the time the CPU is waiting, it looks like our software is not doing anything. We might even think it crashed. And actually, it's waiting on input output. So for instance, if it's the hard drive that is slow, using a SSD drive can make it faster. Or if it's downloading a large amount of data from the internet, it can also we can make it faster by having a larger internet connection.
Excuse-moi, on va faire 5 minutes de pause pour enlever des chaises.
D'accord. Alors, pendant la pause, during the break for the chairs, you have this little screen here that tells you where you can find this little web application that we will use later so that you can send messages to the screen. You can connect to the Wi-Fi connection that will also be displayed here. And I ask you to not share insults or insulting messages on the screen because we want to keep the event fun for everyone. So apart from that, feel free to write some messages. Do you have questions about this CPU bound and I/O bound thing? Like, is it clear for everyone? It's a good problem to have, not enough share. Greg, can you display it? Oh, yeah. Oh, but maybe it's gone now that everyone can write to it. Here. Can you read it? Or?
Zoom the bar on to.
I can't make.
He's asking for the web link.
The web link? Okay. Has anyone have got a chair? Cool. So, another thing that we have in Python, and which is a blocker to have multiple cores, like to use multiple cores per process, is the GIL. I don't know if you noticed, but it's really rare to talk about threads and Python. And because of this great interpreter lock, that makes it impossible to run both threads at exactly the same time. And because of this, most of the time, a multi-threaded software in Python will be slower than the threadless counterpart. So it's really rare to use threads in Python because of this. And AsyncIO will solve that problem because it's a coroutine is much more light than a thread. So my first use case was one I had at Chef Club. So Gusto is our Chef Club mascot. And we wanted to download all the video that we made. So at Chef Club, we make a recipes video. I don't know if you knew that. And we have 6 new video every day. And at some point, we had a large catalog of videos that we wanted to encode for mobile. So in mobile, we have there is a protocol that is called HLS. I don't know if you know about that, but the player can ask the server to give the best compression regarding the bandwidth. So we will say I can download at 300 kilobytes per second. So give me a video that doesn't use more than 300 kilobytes per second. And the quality will automatically increase or decrease with regard to the bitrate. And so we wanted to download all the videos and encode them for mobile in the 3 different qualities. And if you do that with a normal Python software, you will download all the videos in a for loop, for instance. And then you will encode all the videos in another for loop. Or you will download one, encode it, download the second, encode it. Depends. But I wanted to do something a bit more like closer to. I wanted to have something that downloads and encodes at the same time, basically. And as soon as the first video is downloaded, I want to encode it and download the second in the meantime. And Async.io is really good at that. So this is an unreadable flow diagram. But basically, we send a task in our back office of recipes. And then it adds a video to a queue. And then we have a worker that takes the video, encode it, and then upload it to the CDN, and call the back office, say, oh, it's ready now. And so the plan was to download all the video as quickly as possible. As soon as the video is downloaded, we encode it with FFmpeg. And as soon as it's encoded, we upload it to the CDN. So in Async.io, in the documentation of Async.io, you've got this producer-consumer design pattern that I will explain in a minute. And we also have something that is called async subprocesses that will let us run a subprocess and not block the Python code until it's done. And this is really good because it allows us to run something without, like in another CPU or in another process without to have the limitation of the GIL. So first of it, we will also introduce the queues concept. The queue is something that will allow us to communicate between multiple coroutines. So Async.io gives us this queue object. And then I pass it to my two coroutines, download producer and encode consumer. And I will use Async.io.gather to run both the encoder and the producer at the same time. And the queue will be used to communicate between the two coroutines. So for the download producer, I have a download video coroutines that we will see later. And as soon as I downloaded it, I have this video ID that I can put in the queue. And in the consumer, I wait until there is no more ID. So to stop the consumer, I can send the non-value in the queue, and it will stop the encode consumer. And then, if I have an ID, I will use another coroutine to encode the video. And subprocesses, so Async.io gives us this create subprocess exec thing. I can also choose to keep the std out and std error for this process. I await until the program is done, and then I have the access to the output. And in this case, I just use a YouTube download the video URL, and it will run it in another process, and it will release the event loop because it will put this in the wait mode, and I can continue to do things in my Python software. Python code. The second use case is this screen. So you might not know, but writing on the screen means that we need to activate or deactivate the LEDs. And in this screen, we have a lot of LEDs. And it's really CPU intensive to maintain the LEDs. And in the meantime, also because we are working on a Raspberry Pi, which is one process. And in the meantime, we want to download the messages. So it looks a little bit like we have both an I/O bound and a CPU bound software. So the plan is to allow members of the Slack channels to write messages on the screen. And then we want to display the message three and scroll it three times. And we want to manage two really independent lines. So if we don't have a message for the second line, we still want to display the first line. So to do that, we use a couple of libs. First one is the server of IO HTTP and IO Redis. Why we did that? Because for a Slack bot, you need to create a service, a web service, that will receive the message, do something, and give back a response. And we choose to do it with IO HTTP. So we have a first coroutine that will receive all the message from the bot. We use Redis so that we have a queue to store the messages. And then, so when this coroutine is requested, we will get the data, and then we will add the data in the Redis queue, which is called splash screen, and then we enter copy that, which will be written by the bots on the Slack channel. And we need something for our screen, so we will get the message from the list, the splash screen queue. And then if we have a message, we will return the message, and if we don't have one, we will say there is nothing. So it's simple enough, and then we can run a web server with these two endpoints. So my first coroutine, I plug it on the post event of the slashbot URL. My second one on the get event of the slashbot URL. I run my app, and then the Python script can answer requests. So then on the Raspberry Pi, I run this IO HTTP code. So I have a producer that will get the messages from the bot, from the web server. So I create a session. I use this session to make a request. If I have a 200, it means I had a message. I can add it to the consumer queue. And then I wait 10 seconds. So here it's really important to use asyncio.sleep rather than time.sleep. Because if you use time.sleep, you block on this coroutine. And if you use asyncio.sleep, you will release the coroutine, put it in wait mode, and it will be able to do other coroutine while this one is waiting. And then in the other side, we want to read the messages, but we don't want to wait if the message is not there yet. So we have this blocking thing here, which is a Boolean here. By default, it's false. So by default, we don't want to wait when we read the message. The only time we want to wait is when we start the software, because we don't want to run the code if we don't have any messages. So if we wait, we use await. It will put this coroutine in wait. It will run this one, and it will wait for a message before putting it back to ready. And if we use q.getNoWait, it will not block, and it will raise a qempty exception in case there is no messages. That's basically it. Then I have two functions that are write first line and write second line on a buffer. And I make an iterator so that I can calculate dynamically all the position of the line. So that's the code that you can see here. I have my RGB matrix. I create a buffer, which will allow me to do some double buffering. So prepare the message and switch it once it's ready. And then I get the next message by blocking the first time. And then in the while true code, I won't be blocking anymore. So I get my iterator, and then I use yeah. And then I use next, it's not here, but I use next to be able to write it to the buffer, and then I sleep, and every 20 milliseconds I change the screen. So for me, Async I/O is a revolution because it allows you to use Python to do this kind of things. And especially if you want to handle WebSockets, where your software is basically waiting all the time. I was working for Mozilla before joining Chef Club, and we were doing this web push software, which is basically a notification for the web browser. And every Firefox running was having a WebSocket with our service, which is about 100 million WebSockets. And we had some limitation because of a number of file descriptors per EC2 instances. But apart from that, it was the fastest solution was to use Python. We wrote it in Go. We wrote it in three or four different languages, in Node.js as well. And I think the last version is in Rust with Tokyo, and it's even faster. But until Rust, Async I/O was a really quick solution. That's it for me. I don't know if you have any questions. Yeah, please. Yeah, so for web push, we did that. So for WebSocket, like, there is a bunch of benchmarks that you can find with IOHTTP and other Async I/O web frameworks. Some are really, really quick. But if you, you need to be really careful that in your coroutine, you release the coroutine the quickest as possible. Like if you do a PostgreSQL collection, you might be tempted not to use a wait call or Async I/O compatible library to talk with your database, for instance. And if you do that, your code will be slower and slower. But if you really use a wait whenever possible, like my manager was joking, that when we call the RAM, we should probably use await as well. I'm not at this step yet, but basically that's the idea of Async I/O. You need to release the coroutine the quickest way possible. Yeah. So the question was, did I run some load test with or benchmark with Async I/O? And yeah, for web push, we did a lot of load tests because the team working on it rewrote the software in all possible languages to make sure we have the smallest RAM memory for each WebSocket. And yeah, but it's really quick. Yeah.
You mentioned that Gatsby runs multiple processes simultaneously, so it uses multiple cores of the processor to run the
processor? No. So Async I/O doesn't run on multiple cores. So you don't have this magical thing in Python yet. Usually what we do is that we set up a protocol to discuss between processes, and then we run multiple processes with Python. Like if you have a web server with WSGI, you will have something like micro WSGI or unicorn to run multiple processes of your server. But yeah, with Async I/O, it's only one process, but the coroutine will, the CPU will turn to one coroutine to the other as soon as there is a wait call. So if you have a lot of await calls, it will be quick enough so that you don't notice. But yeah.
Are they considered coroutines as the same threads or are they different threads?
Yeah, it's basic. So are the coroutine a single thread or multiple threads? It's only one thread. It's there is no even concept of thread. It's one process, one Python process, yes. and the async IO API will manage for you the event loop that that goes from one coroutine to another. So it's not really in parallel, but the switch between one call to the other is quick. So, but if you have a really CPU intensive call in your coroutine, you will slow down the whole process. So that's why in my example, I run a sub-process for all the intensive commands. You have any?
Actually, that was more or less my question.
Ah, okay.
I was wondering if ACPU was implemented as a kind of wrapper on top of the operating module, but that's not the case.
Yeah, and it's so. Async IO it's also a protocol, so you have some other implementation of the IO loop. And for instance, you can use the one from Node.js with Python with libuv. And then the IO loop is managed directly by in C, and it's even faster. So if you notice that your IO loop is really slow, you can try to use UV loop and.
In the background, it uses poll and select, right?
Yeah, probably, yes.
Can you explain again why you think programs that are both CPU bound and IO bound are the best candidate for ACM?
Oh, because it takes the power of the whole computer and it makes the best of both, the internet connection and the CPU. But if it's only IO, yes. IO intensive, it's enough. It's just that your CPU will still be doing nothing most of the time, but.
Prior to async IO, did you consider frameworks like Qiskit, for example?
Yeah, so I worked, so did I consider other framework prior to async IO? So basically, I worked a lot with Tornado and Tornado Web when async IO didn't exist, or when it was impossible for us to work with a so brand new version of Python. But since we, like, now we can use Docker to deploy, and so we can pick whichever version of Python we want, which make it possible for us to use async IO. But for instance, in the Django community, at some point they wanted to build an asynchronous web server that was both compatible with Python 2 and Python 3, and they couldn't rely on async IO. So,
Did you try multiprocessing along with async IO, and if so, how did it run?
So, yeah, multiprocessing, I think the API of multiprocessing has been implemented in async IO with the create subprocess API because. If you use multiprocessing, then you don't really need an IO loop. You can just run your other process. Maybe you can use multiprocessing also to run multiple workers that are using async IO, but I didn't try it yet.
Mm-hmm. Is it the same in Python? And did you already hit this limit? And if so, did you already try to capture this number of threads? And I think the Linux kernel has also 4 threads for the Cisco.
So Node is using 4 processes to run the IO loop. Did I hit the limitation with Python of 1 thread? And is it like so? Basically, I never hit the limitation of using one core with async IO in my use case. But I think the way to work with this limitation is still to run multiple Python processes, as we do with MicroWSGI. And I should do some research, but I don't know if with libuv we can run the IO loop on multiple processes or not with Python. So
if it's a different thread, yeah.
It might be, I don't know.
For testing, if you would like to mock the result of the coroutines, is there any best practice for this?
Yeah, so unfortunately it's not in this talk, but I had to mock, especially when testing WebSockets. So with PyTest, you've got the PyTest Async IO module, which is a plugin of PyTest, and it will let you have test functions that are coroutines, so you can use async await inside your tests as well. And then for mocking, there is also I think it's in the WebSocket module of Python. There is also some testing tools.
What was the first module? So
there is PyTest Async IO.
Yes.
And I wonder if there is also PyTest IO HTTP to mock the client, the HTTP client, for instance.
Okay, thank you. Is it possible to use async functions or async packages in normal code?
Yeah, so, I haven't talked about that either, but that's a really good question, especially if you create a worker and you want to use async io.gather in the middle of it. So you can, in any code that that is not using async IO, you can use the async io.run, and you give it a coroutine, and it will run the coroutine. The only thing that you can't do is to have two loops managed by the same Python process. But if you need one loop at a time, you can use that async io.run, and it will turn this part, like it will run the IO loop. This call will be blocking until the coroutine returns. But in these coroutines, you can use any
so
other coroutines.
So if we build a package that is based on async IO, then our users will have to import async io.run in order to call our functions.
You can also hide it for them, but yes. Basically, at some point, if you want to run async IO code, you need to use async io.run.
Yeah, but maybe the users don't even know about async IO and they just want a fast module.
It depends where is your UI with your users, but if they're
the
just from
other developers.
Yeah. So. They might, if it's IO lib, they might want to use directly the await name of the function, or if I don't know.
Because in the end, in fact, if you work in the async io.run call, then the function will be transformed into a standard function blocking until the end of the execution.
Yeah. But you can also create this function that do the async io.run. The good thing is that since Python 3.5, async IO is part of the standard library, so they don't need to install any other library. But then you might want to restrict to 3.6 if you want to use async await. I think there were a question over there as well. No? Here?
Did you find all the async bindings you needed for the technology you have to interface with, or are there still limitations as of today?
So today, I think it happens that I want to port. For instance, I had to call the Amazon MWS API, so there were only a request-based version of the client. But in this case, it was easy to fork it and to make it async IO. But for everything that is really common, like PostgreSQL, Redis, WebSockets, everything is already there. But it can happen that if you use an exotic service, maybe it doesn't exist yet, but you can use IO HTTP to make your HTTP calls instead.
And all this async bindings managed by the same team that does the official bindings, or
not necessarily, yeah.
All right. Thank you. Thanks a lot.